सरपाल डॉक्टर रंजीत राणा प्लीज। वी हैव गॉट 10 पेपर्स इन दिस सेशन एंड देर इज वन बेस्ट पेपर फ्रॉम राजस्थान ऑफ ऑप्टोमेटिकल सोसाइटी एंड वन कीनोट एड्रेस। सो चेयरमैन सर
the who is present the first presenter is available here the first person
Dr. Sanket Bhatnagar
yeah Dr. Sanket Bhatnagar please start the presentation
DM1 first slide it has been uploaded there How do they speak and know that how many minutes? Yeah, but how do they?
It's not coming.
The time for you is 6 minutes.
Yes.
Start now.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Dr. Sanket, and I'll be presenting my paper on decoding intermittent cataracts using intraocularity, the MACPOD classification. So, an intermittent cataract is always a technically challenging case because of the difficulty in excess manipulation, presence of fluid leak, and high lenticular pressure, and also lack of clarity in the posterior capsule integrity. So, a combination of all these things can lead to situations like these.
Sanket, excuse me. The next presenter is Dr. Manpreet Kaur. Is she there? Then Dr. Rajendra Prasad.
Oh. And
you can prepare on this.
Videos are not playing.
Yeah, please go ahead. And the combination of all three can spell disaster for the most skilled cataract surgeon. So it's going back, sir. So do we have a savior beyond the operating microscope? The answer is yes. We can use the Zeiss Riscan 700 intraop OCT, which uses a Lumera 700 surgical microscope with an integrated spectral domain OCT, which gives two OCT images, vertical and horizontal, at a scan depth of 2 mm of the tissue. It gives a real-time imaging during the surgery and shows the thickness of capsule, fluid clefts, elevation of lens center, and also regression of the liquefied cortex if present. This brings us to the research question that is, can we find risk factors for capsular excess extension by using intraop real-time imaging using Riscan 700? So coming to our methodology, we included 30 eyes of 30 patients with intumescent MATCAT diagnosed on slit lamp. The surgery was done by a single surgeon. During capsular excess, a micro-excess forceps was used, viscote was injected, and capsular decompression was done. Retrospectively, the video and the still images from the video were analyzed. Based on the structure and anatomy of the fluid clefts, we saw anterior fluid spaces, irregularly distributed anterior fluid spaces, central fluid clefts, diffusely distributed fluid clefts, and posterior fluid clefts. So based on the structure and morphological characteristics of these fluid clefts, we came up with this MACPOD classification, which had 5 patients with minimal fluid clefts, 8 with anterior fluid clefts, 5 with central, 5 with posterior, and 7 with diffuse. So coming to the characteristics of each, We saw that the risk of recess extension was lowest in the minimal fluid clefts category, with lesser chances of fluid cleft, fluid leak, and the shape of the capsule maintained flat throughout the throughout the recess. But the risk increases as we saw presence of fluid clefts being there. It also showed, sorry, the videos are not playing, sir. So it also showed compression of the capsule on injection of viscode. As we can see, pre-visco injection.
Can the video, audio-visual people please help? The video is not running.
I'll just continue it. Pause.
I think Sanket, you should continue.
I'll.
Can you make the light off, please?
Sanket, are they doing it?
So they are working on something, but I can't even move forward. I think it's paused or something there. Okay.
I think you should continue. Just leave the video. That is the only problem.
So as we can see, eventually in the video you can see as the viscote is injected, there is a depression in the anterior lens capsule which can be seen real time in the OCT also. So before the injection, the lens size is this much. After the injection, it decreases in size. So coming to the discussion, it is a descriptive study to demonstrate proof of concept. It's an excellent tool for teaching and research, and still images taken from the video and machine do not provide a very good resolution for mathematical analysis and modeling for calculating the curvature of lens, which this machine can actually do. The magnitude of flattening of anterior capsular convexity in response to heavy OVDs help us to differentiate cases with fluid within the lens fibers, which where the anterior capsule is a little non-compressible and there is higher risk of recess runoff despite taking all the precautions, and also presence of fluid between the lens fiber which flattens on compression by OVD, and AC puncture is likely to release the fluid and reduce the risk of runoff. So to conclude, morphology of the fluid clefts demonstrate ease of pressure release on anterior capsular puncture, and curvature of anterior capsule and its change with OVD can be a surrogate indicator of the raised intralenticular pressure. Thank you.
How it has helped in your visual outcome, this outcome of the surgery?
So visual, we didn't
because
find any.
Because you told that it helps in research.
Yes, sir. So yeah. While teaching as a fellow or a PG, we can actually show, see, this is the fluid cleft actually we can show on the live image of the patient as well. We can see the fluid clefts, but it's very morphological, very superficial. On the OCT itself, we can see, okay, posterior fluid cleft, the chances of intralenticular fluid release might be less. If the anterior clefts are there, runoff risk is more, lenticular pressure is high. So we can actually differentiate that, and then maybe if we incorporate this into practice, skills might increase. Visual outcome depends on the skill of the surgeon itself also.
And which particular microscope is used in your study?
So, Zeiss microscope, sir.
Zeiss, okay.
It's an incorporated machine. Rescan comes with the Zeiss microscope. It's a addition to that, sir.
You know, have you found that when there is multiple things are attached, other than the,
yes,
you know, real picture, additional of the, you know, toric marker and extra,
yes,
does it reduce the resolution of a
no, sir,
picture?
In
no.
This, the magnification and resolution of the microscope doesn't decrease.
Remains same. Oh,
yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Anurag, can you start?
Yes, sir, Dr. Rajan Prasad, please go ahead.
Good afternoon, friends and chairman, chairpersons over here. My paper is on high dissect. This is a new surgical technique in the management of complex posterior polar cataract. I have no financial interest in the subject matter of this film. You know that posterior polar cataract is one of the challenge, and the problem with the posterior polar cataract is it's the intraoperative pre-extraction posterior capsular disruption. So that is the main problem. We are worried about that. And even with the routine phaco forces or any attempt to detach the plaque from the posterior capsule, you may get into the complete disruption of the posterior capsule and the complications. The incidence has been put from 36% to 40% by most of the leading surgeons. And there are many techniques to deal with the posterior polar cataract. We all have been practicing all these. But most of these techniques, they refer to the simple posterior polar cataract, where there is no anomaly of the posterior capsule. Posterior capsule is intact, but it's weak and fragile, and you see the plaque behind the lens near the posterior capsule, but it is not fused with the posterior capsule. So that is the simpler form of the posterior polar cataract. But none of these techniques has referred to the treacherous complex posterior polar cataract, where there is a posterior capsular anomaly associated with the posterior pole cataract. And this is like if you have a fused posterior polar cataract with the posterior capsule, there is a defect in the posterior capsule, there could be complete absence of the posterior capsule, then what to do? So these are the situations we have been finding trouble, and we have been getting into the problem during the surgery and landing up with the many complications. So the purpose of the study was to describe efficacy of new surgical approach that is called as a high dissect in the management of complex posterior polar cataract and minimizing the risk of further disruption of the posterior capsule and prevent posterior segment complications and also in preventing pre-extraction posterior capsular disruption. So you do not want to have the posterior capsular disruption before you extract the nucleus and the rest of the material from the capsular bag. 10 cases of posterior polar cataract were selected from the RPI Institute in the year 2015 to 2017. On the basis of clinical examination, cases were grouped into two simple and complex posterior polar cataract. Cases of complex posterior polar cataract was taken up for the study. So we took the patients for complete clinical examination with biomicroscopy and anterosegment OCT to differentiate the complex and the simple form of the posterior polar cataract. They underwent the complete evaluation of the fundus evaluation also. So out of 10 cases, 4 were simple posterior polar cataract and 6 of them were complex posterior polar cataract. All the 6 cases of complex posterior polar cataract underwent high dissect. The high dissect is a bimanual irrigation and aspiration control. So the whole surgery is done with the bimanual irrigation and aspiration control. So it's a very simple technique, and for epinuclear cortical polar cataract is plaque extraction with simultaneous capsulorhexis formation, the PPC, like the posterior capsulorhexis formation. So the surgical approach was taken up in preventing pre-extraction posterior capsular disruption and in minimizing the risk of further disruption of the posterior capsule and prevent posterior segment complications, preventing too much of stress on the compromised posterior capsule and help to convert the posterior capsular tear into the posterior capsular axis. So surgery, just run the video.
Sorry for interruption. May I request Dr. Gaurav Gupta, is he there? You please be prepared on the next podium.
After doing the incisions and the capsular axis, the central capsular axis, you have to do a hydrodissection, but that should be multi-quadrant hydrodissection. You should not do the complete cortical cleaving hydrodissection. That is very important. And then do the hydrodelineation, a very little hydrodelineation to separate the nucleus from the cataractous complex. Once you complete this, then the phacoemulsification should be slow motion phacoemulsification with very low infusion pressure, very low aspiration rate, low energy level, and low stress on the posterior capsule so that you do not disrupt the posterior capsule during the emulsification of the nucleus. So you crack the nucleus and then take each pieces slowly and very swiftly. You have to do this without putting too much of pressure, without any manipulation in the capsular bag. Emulsify the nucleus. Once you emulsify the nucleus, then you could see the thick epinucleus that is removed with the partial segmentation technique, that is cortical and epinuclear aspiration. Very slowly, some amount of the epinucleus is aspirated, and then use the bimanual irrigation and aspiration cannula to aspirate the cortex. The cortex has to be aspirated, but you should not come to the center of the plaque. So you can see here the plaque is in the center. We have aspirated almost everything from the periphery, the cortex, epinucleus, and everything, because but you could see the central plaque. So this is the important point. Like, you should not touch the central plaque in the beginning. Leave it for the last, the central plaque. You could see the central plaque. And then with the irrigation and aspiration cannula, you have to remove this central plaque slowly by putting traction on the posterior capsule. So you have to hold it, catch it, put traction, and then aspirate it as much as possible, slowly and slowly. Hold it, put traction, and then aspirate. So traction we are putting on the posterior capsule to make the posterior capsular axis also along with. So all the three things are done together, the removal of the plaque. So you can see now finally you remove the plaque and your cataract is out. And once your cataract is out, you put the IOL in, and the results were very satisfying. Like in all the cases, we could do this successful PCC in all six cases. The visual recovery was very, very good in all the cases. And to conclude, the bimanual low vacuum controlled aspiration of the cataractous plaque while creating a controlled posterior capsular axis, that is high dissect, is a very suitable surgical technique in the management of the complex posterior polar cataract to prevent further disruption of the posterior capsule and posterior and the potential complications. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Good presentation. Have you tried inside out hydro?
Tried what?
In these cases, what have you tried inside out hydro dissection?
See, inside out hydro, as I told in the beginning itself, if you have a simpler form of the posterior polar cataract, you can try anything. But if you have a complex form of the posterior polar cataract where you have a posterior capsular defect, or you have an anomaly of the posterior capsule, or if there is a complete adhesion of the cataractous plaque with the posterior capsule, you can't try anything else. You try, everything will disrupt and go into the vitreous. So that is the reason this high dissect is a very simple technique where you do not touch the center first. You touch the center last. So that even if anything goes into the vitreous, it's a minimal amount which you can very easily aspirate and complete. Inside-out hydro dissection is a very, 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 very difficult phenomenon. Like if you don't have the adhesion of the plaque with the posterior capsule, then you can try it. But if there is adhesion, then you cannot try.
Yeah, I think you mistaken, sir. This one, the hydro, the sculpting, sorry, the removing the nucleus by cutting and then injecting from inside saves your center of the complex nature. And you can also rotate the nucleus and remove them without affecting the center.
That is for the nucleus. So as I told you, nucleus, you can try any technique. not for the plaque or the epinucleus or the cortex. For the cortex, you cannot do this inside out dissection. The dissection can be done for the nucleus. Because nucleus is in any case, nucleus is not adhered with the cataractous plaque. Nucleus is away. You can separate the nucleus and then emulsify nucleus as you feel like. If it's very soft, you just aspirate it. If it is a little mildly brittle nucleus, you can crack it as I was doing it. Crack it and then don't use chopping. That is very clear. In these cases, don't do chopping, because if you do chopping, you are going to put too much of stress on the posterior capsule and it can disrupt. So do cracking simply and very slowly hold the nucleus pieces and aspirate, as emulsify and aspirate.
One more question.
Yeah.
Knowing well that there is a defect in the posterior capsule and then doing hydrodissection, you're inviting, it may lead to rupture of the dehiscence of the posterior capsule and leads to nucleus drop.
Your question is very valid, but you probably didn't hear what I said in the beginning. The point is, you don't do cortical cleaving hydrodissection in these cases. That is very, very clear and 100% clear. You do multi-quadrant small injections of the fluid, because you have to separate the cortex from the capsule. Because when it comes to aspiration of the cortex, if you don't separate, then again you are going to put too much stress on the capsule. So you have to separate, but don't do cortical cleaving hydrodissection. That is very clear. So we are not doing cortical cleaving. If you do cortical cleaving hydrodissection, then you can disrupt the posterior capsule in the beginning itself. But it's a multi-quadrant, very small injections of the fluid in the periphery, which will save you from the disruption, as well as it separates the cortex from the capsule, and it becomes very easy to aspirate the cortical material from the capsular bag.
I think it's a very good presentation. Here you want to give a very clear message that you should have a minimum intraocular pressure fluctuation by controlled IA.
Yeah.
And there's the trick of this technique.
Yeah.
Okay.
The plaque should be left for the last. So that is the message.
Yeah. Thank
plaque
you.
Should be left for the last. Don't touch the plaque in the beginning. That is the most important point in this technique.
Okay, request next speaker, Dr.
Thank you. Yes, he wants to ask something. I don't know.
I think okay.
I'm Dr. Pawan. I'm working as an ophthalmologist in the Indian Air Force, presently posted at Gorakhpur. So especially we see a lot of, I'm a lone surgeon there. So this inside out approach, sir, frankly, probably takes a lot of getting used to. It's not easy.
Yeah, it's not
after
easy.
You sculpt it, the way Prof. Vasavda does it, by you know just getting that good delineation, frankly, it happens very rarely and it's not easy. And I agree that do not hydrodissect in a posterior polyact is our normal surgical dogma. But you cannot, sir, have that luxury in these where you already have a pre-existing defect. So how does one make love to a porcupine? Very, very carefully is the answer. So in this context, unless you loosen up by a multi-dissection approach like you mentioned.
Multi-quadrant
thing,
yeah.
You have to juggle between the devil and the deep blue sea. And say never lose chamber, always have a viscoelastic in the side port or the irrigation, as the case may be. Thank you very much, sir. That's all.
I think the time is running out, so yeah. Thank you. You go to the next speaker, Dr. Gaurav Gupta.
Very good afternoon to all. Myself, Dr. Gaurav Gupta. My
request, Dr.
Titiyal. In the meantime, Dr. Titiyal, you get ready on the next podium.
My paper is on efficacy of intravitreal dexamethasone implant in patients of uveitis undergoing cataract surgery. Uveitis is not an uncommon disease in developing countries and is a common cause of blindness. Cataract is the most common complication, and in such cases, blindness can be easily prevented by doing cataract surgery. But performing cataract surgery in such cases is a challenge due to high chance of postoperative inflammation. To control this inflammation postoperatively, oral steroids have been used since long, but they have been associated with a lot of side effects. So need for an alternative therapy have been realized. Dexamethasone posterior segment drug delivery system is a sustained release intravitreal implant containing 700 microgram of dexamethasone. It has a longer duration of action. In this prospective randomized study, we compared intravitreal dexamethasone implant with standard of care in controlling postoperative inflammation following PECO for uveitic cataract. Hair inflammation was measured using laser flare photometry. To the best of our knowledge, this first of its kind starting. This is a prospective study which included 30 eyes of 30 patients with uveitis with visually significant cataract. These patients were randomized into two groups. First, standard of care group, which comprised of patients who underwent phacoemulsification with IOL implantation and received standard of care for uveitis perioperative. Second group was DEXA group, which additionally received intraoperative intravitreal dexamethasone implant. We included patients with age more than 15 years and who had control of uveitis for at least 3 months prior to cataract surgery with preoperatively LFP readings of less than 50. And patients with active uveitis, history of steroid-induced glaucoma, scleritis, diabetes mellitus were excluded. Patients were followed for at least 6 months. On each visit, laser flare photometry readings for measuring flare, best-corrected visual acuity, intraocular pressures were noted. Spectral domain OCT was done at 6 weeks, 3 months, and 6 months. Data was analyzed using SPSS software. Coming to the results, in our SOC group, there were 16 patients, and DEXA group had 14 patients. In the study group, the 10 were males and 20 were females with mean age of 49.36 years. 16 patients were of anterior uveitis, 5 of intermediate uveitis, and 9 of panuveitis. Here in this table, we can see the preoperative characteristics of both standard of care groups and DEXA groups. They were statistically similar in terms of best-corrected visual acuity, IOP, and laser flare photometry preoperatively. Now coming to the post-operative results, this is a chart showing flare which was measured on laser flare photometry. We can see the flare was, there was a spike of flare on post-operative day one in both the groups, but the spike was very high in SOC group as compared to the DEXA group. In further follow-up visits, the spike came down to the preoperative values, but this spike came very fast down to normal in DEXA group. Here we can see within 2 to 4 weeks it came down to preoperative value. But in SOC group it take around 12 weeks, that is 3 months to came down to the preoperative value. This is the table showing that the results were statistically significant on various follow-up visits. Six patients in the SOC group developed central macular edema and no patient in our DEXA group developed any CME. The mean CMT was statistically lower in the DEXA group at various follow-up visits, and it was statistically significant. Now, on coming to the best-corrected visual acuity, we can see the best-corrected visual acuity improved in both the groups as compared to the preoperative value, but the improvement was much better in the DEXA group as compared to the standard of care group, and this improvement on various follow-up visits was statistically significant. That is, DEXA group developed much better best-corrected visual acuity at various follow-up visit and on also in the last follow-up visit. In IOP, in both the groups, there was no statistical difference in at various follow-up visit. No patient developed any IOP rise at any follow-up visit in our study group. In complication, standard of care group, one patient had fibrin and one developed post-operative hypotony, but in DEXA group, no patient had any CME, hypotony, fibrin, or IOP rise, but one patient developed vitreous hemorrhage, which also resolved spontaneously. There was no case of steroid-induced ocular hypertension or glaucoma in our study population. The flare rise was significantly lower in the DEXA group as shown than standard of care group in majority of the visits, and the rate at which the flare came back to its preoperative value was much faster in DEXA group, that is, patient had early and better recovery in DEXA group. In our study, 75% in the SOC group achieved vision better than or equal to 20/40, and in DEXA group, most of the patient achieved vision better than or equal to 20/40 after 6 months, although 28.5% vision between 20/30 and 20/40. So we believe that the standard of care treatment, which is usually given for control of inflammation in uveitis cases, and on which the inflammation is controlled preoperatively, is not sufficient to control the inflammation postoperatively, and additional steroids or immunosuppressive agents are needed for postoperative control. Limitation of our study was small sample size and non-documentation of CME preoperatively, but the strengths were it is first of its kind, randomized control study, and inflammation was measured objectively using laser flare photometry, thereby removing investigator bias. So our study shows that use of intraoperative intravitreal implant results in less postoperative inflammation, faster recovery, better visual outcome, less incidence of CME, and minimal adverse effect. So we concluded DEXA implant is a safe and effective option for preventive and managing the postoperative inflammation in uveitic cataract cases, and also in preventing the complication of cataract surgery in these cases. Thank you.
Is it the cost of the injection is worth the effect you get it?
Yes, sir. Our study has shown like if we will not do anything in such cases, 37.5% will eventually develop CME and then they will need some sort of treatment. But if we will give something that is implant, who are affordable, then the patient deserve to get a better visual outcome and also no complication.
When you follow a method of when the uveitis is quiet for some time, for at least 3 months, then you take up the case.
Yes, sir.
Till you need the dexamethasone.
Yes, sir. We have taken up only those cases who are quiet. That is, as the standard guideline says, ki we need to the eye need to be quiet for at least 3 months. So we have taken only those patients who were quiet on whatever treatment, that is on standard of care treatment for uveitis for 3 months, then only they were taken up for surgery. Other patients who were have active uveitis or other cases were excluded. And also the previous studies have also shown that whatever the treatment, the eye is quiet. The previous study has shown like 28% to 56% patient develop CME postoperatively. But in our study, none of our patients developed postoperative CME, and also the recovery was faster and the visual outcome was much better as compared to the standard of care group.
Do you get 6 months effect with this drug?
Sir, the company says it takes 6 months, but our experience has shown that 3 months the effects wear off, but still we have continued.
Not more than 2 months, sir. Most of the cases.
Okay.
Did you use intraoperative steroids?
No, sir. Intraoperative, like.
In the control group?
Intraoperative, like oral steroids?
In oral steroids as well as injectable steroids?
No injection.
Subconjunctival?
Subconjunctival. Post-operatively, we routinely.
Talking of intraoperative.
Yes, sir. Intraoperatively, at the end of the surgery, we routinely give 4mg dexamethasone to every patient subconjunctively.
In the control group?
In control group also. This is a routine stand we do. Sorry.
See, we find if you give if the patient is on 60 milligram of prednisolone for 2 days before, 1 day on surgery, 2 days after, and then this is with the subconjunctival injection, the results are very good.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Oral steroids have. There are studies where oral steroids have been used, and they are traditionally been used, and they are able to control the inflammation postoperatively also. But they have been associated with a lot of side effects. So there was a need. This is only 700 microgram, and what we give orally 60 mg, that is 1,000 times more the dose, and it is only once given. Intraoperatively, the patient need not to take orally medication, compliance is better, and also there is no side effect like the weight gain. We routinely see moon facies, weight gain, and a lot of side effects with the oral steroids.
It cannot be given in complicated cases like where it is diabetes and all?
Yes, sir. In diabetes, we can give, and there is another study going on which says that Ozodex is effective in preventing the CME due to diabetes, but we excluded the diabetic patient because it would have been biased that the CME has occurred due to diabetic retinopathy itself or the uveitis. So we have excluded the diabetic patients also to make the study pure and no bias.
Thank you, Gaurav.
Okay, thank you.
The next speaker is Dr. J.S. Tityal. And before that, may I request Dr.
Particular work. This is a paper on a comparative evaluation of nucleotomy patterns in femtosecond laser-assisted cataract surgery. No financial disclosure from our side. We all know femtosecond laser-assisted surgery in phaco does give a decreased phaco time, decreased effective phaco time in all cases. Let it be a soft nucleus to hard nucleus. And there has been studies to prove that if you do a fragmentation pattern, it gives you a lesser phaco energy in cases of femtosecond laser assisted surgery with catalyst device. We have used Lensix laser platform, and this is one of the first study which has compared the CHOP pattern versus the matrix pattern in these cases. And we wanted to evaluate the intraoperative and postoperative outcomes with matrix and CHOP nucleotomy patterns in flex surgeries. And this was a prospective randomized controlled trial of 66 IEs. Group 1, that was matrix pattern, 33 eyes, and group 2, that was CHOP pattern, 33 eyes. We included only grade 3 and 4 nucleotomy, nucleus sclerosis with LOCS grade 3 pattern. Patients with good dilatation were included in these cases. Any pupil less than 6 millimeters, pseudo-explosion syndrome, glaucoma, posterior segment pathologies, prior ocular surgery were excluded from this particular study group. Use a Lensix 2.23 software in this group of cases in matrix pattern. We use 4 millimeter grid, 350 micron fragments, 2 horizontal cuts, 8 radial spokes, and 1 millimeter length was used. For chop pattern, we use a 3 chop in these cases, or 6 millimeter length in these cases. Subsequently, use a Centurion FACO machine for all these cases. The primary outcome for our study was intraop FACO emulsification parameters and post-op anterior-chamber inflammation. And secondary parameters were intraop complication, post-op central macular thickness, post-op visual acuity, and post-op endothelial cell counts. And we followed these patients for day 1 and 30-day post-op period. In terms of demographic profile, both groups were similar in age, sex, and type of nuclear sclerosis. Looking into a total amount of time taken for laser application for making chop and fragment, we found that chop took fragment took more time than a chop pattern. But in terms of CDE, that is a cumulative dissipated energy, the matrix pattern took less energy than a chop pattern. Similarly, ultrasonic time was especially less with the matrix pattern than a chop pattern. Total aspiration time and total duration of FACO was almost significantly non-difference in the two group of cases. In 350 micron fragment, which we used for a matrix pattern, did give a very nice emulsification of these cases, so that our CDE was significantly less compared to the chop pattern in these cases. Looking into a complication-wise, we didn't have any complication in our cases. Looking into day one corneal assessment, we did have a mild central edema in 22% in a matrix pattern and 33% in chop pattern of these cases, which significantly improved subsequently. And corrected and uncorrected visual acuity was similar in both the groups as such. But looking into anti-chamber flare, which was measured by a cell flare meter, we found that matrix pattern had significantly less cell flare at day 1 as well as at day 30 also, which was significantly better than a chop pattern in these group of cases. And this highly significant reaction does reflect that the surgical time is a very significant parameter for creating a post-op inflammation and resolution of post-op inflammation in these cases as such. We do not have any patient developing a significant macular edema on OCT measurement in these cases in both the groups, though there have been studies where they have realized that if you use more energy and more FACO time, they did have an incidence of CME in those group of cases. In terms of endothelial cell count, we measured at 30-day post-op in these cases. From pre-op, we did find a significant better endothelial cell count in a cases we undergone a grid pattern or matrix pattern as compared to the chop pattern. We feel that would be a significant consideration for patients who have endothelial disorder. The grid pattern may be more significantly better to avoid further damage to endothelium in these cases, though further studies may be required in this group of cases. To conclude, both matrix and chop pattern, which is available with the LensX platform, both give an effective emulsification with FACO in these cases. But the energy used for a matrix was very less compared to the chop pattern, and subsequent AC cell flare meter measurement of flare and endothelial cell count does support that nucleotomy by matrix pattern, and subsequent FACO gives better results in these cases. Thank you for your kind listening, sir.
Thank you, sir. So how is your matrix pattern is different from the hybrid pattern?
In the hybrid pattern, what we do, we make a chop and the circle pattern combination. In matrix pattern, we make a central 6 millimeter various small cubicles rather than making a chop. We don't have a chop. It has only peripheral spokes of 8 spokes beyond the chop grid pattern. So it's slightly different than a hybrid pattern.
So do you believe that it is the FACO time or the nucleus removal is more impact on the endothelium rather than the fluid current or the physical movement of the probe inside the eye? Which one is that?
Because surgery was similar by the same surgeon of both the groups, it is the ease of emulsification of a piece which is important. If you have a smaller piece, they can be emulsified much better in the back than a larger piece which you get a chop, because 3 chops will give you 6 segments. And these six segments are quite big and they require a more emulsification. That's the only difference here.
How much is your fluid difference between the matrix and the other segments? Is there a volume of fluid used different?
In terms of total surgical time, it was almost similar, the duration of surgery. But the energy used for emulsification was more with the chop pattern because the pieces are a little bigger. So we had to use more energy there, maybe we have to further chop those pieces to make it smaller, especially grade 3 and 4 require more energy. The volume is slightly bigger also. Once you make a grid pattern, the central nucleus becomes softer. And that's a critical part in the FACO, the central part is the harder one. That is the only difference here.
Sir, it is good presentation. I think you could have included it one or two videos also of the each method.
Yeah, this is a paper good presentation. I thought we should
thank
avoid.
You. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
So, Dr. J.G. Agarwal, go ahead.
Yes, Mr. Chairperson.
And the next speaker is Dr. Sangeeta Kalita. Is she there? Oh, okay.
My topic is very important for today's perspective because many cases are coming with preoperative LASIKs. Here, the IOL power calculation after myopic LASIK or PRK, whether it is SCRS calculator or Aramberry adjustment using the SRKT. Predictive refractive outcome after the cataract surgery is more difficult in eyes that have undergone LASIK or PRK. The purpose of the study is to get the correct IOL power after myopic LASIK and to compare the different powers obtained from the SCRS calculator, including the Barrett 2K formula or Aramberry adjustment for SRKT. A retrospective chart review was conducted in the consecutive patients with previous LASIK for myopia and subsequent head cataract surgery. Number of patients are 19, age between 32 to 48. Maximum data regarding the previous cataract surgery was taken from the patient. Three situations can arise by getting pre-LASIK keratotomy and refractive data. This option is no longer available in SCRS calculator, so not considered in this study. The surgically induced manifest refraction changes, that is MR, and then current anterior corneal power measurement value. And third situation is with where there is no history data, that is no MR is available. We enter all the data obtained from the corneal topography, IOL master readings, and the OCT into the ACRS IOL calculator, and we get 8 formula results, that is Masket, modified Masket, SAMAS, Hegisel, Barrett 2K, OCT, and Barrett 2K, no history, and average. For two cases, I have used SRKT formula correction table, Aramberry double K methods. The results from the different formula of the SCRA calculator were compared. When no pre-diffractive data is available, the Barrett 2K formula was compared with the SAMAS and Hegisel no history formula. The inclusion criteria were no complications during the and after the cataract surgery. Exclusion criteria includes major complication including the during and after cataract surgery. These are the data from all 19 cases. And calculate IOL power of all 19 cases by SCRS calculator and Aramberry adjustment on SRKT. These are the prediction error calculated, IOL prediction error, refractive prediction error, in which the mean arithmetic refracting prediction error, mean absolute refracting prediction error, variance in the mean refractive prediction error, and the percentage of eye within certain refractive prediction error. Here there are two prediction errors, is the percentage of eye within the refractive error of 0.5, that is IOL prediction error is 0.71, and within one diopter, that is IOL prediction error is 1.43 diopter. Assuming that the one diopter of IOL prediction error produces 0.75 diffractive error in the respectable plane. A statistical analysis was performed by Strata. These are demographic distribution of all 19 cases. Here the IOL prediction error, it is shown that the Barrett 2K and the Barrett 2K no history gives the minimum IOL prediction error. Regarding the refractive prediction error, here again, the Barrett 2K and the Barrett 2K no history method gives mean arithmetic error with standard deviation and mean absolute prediction error with standard deviation are lowest in these cases. These are the modified Band Altman plot graph for each method illustrating IOL prediction error for all 19 patients. The red line represents the IOL prediction error to 0, the green line represents the prediction error of 0.71, and the blue line represents the prediction error of 1.43. Here it is shown that the Barrett 2K readings are very close to 0. Here again, the Barrett 2K history, Barrett 2K with no history again, the readings are very close to 0. This is the same thing is shown in the blot plot graph. Here again, it is shown that the Barrett 2K and the Barrett 2K no history method, refraction prediction is very near to 0. this, when there is no history method, when the Arambri adjustment of SRKT was compared with Samas, Hegesel, and Barrett-2K, here again, the readings in the for Barrett-2K no history method are very close to zero, where Arambri adjustment on SRKT is around 0.5 to 1 diopters. The same thing is shown in the blot plot graph. For Barrett-2K, the Barrett-2K mean absolute prediction error is significantly lower than the mean absolute prediction error for all other methods. The variance in the refractive numerical prediction error, here again, with or without history, again, the Barrett-2K and the Barrett-2K no history, it is very less. Refractive index, refractive prediction error within 0.5 diopter to 1 diopter. Here again, with the patient calculated by the Barrett-2K and the Barrett-2K no history give maximum number of cases in between. The limitation of this study includes a small sample. It affects the standard statistical significance, but prediction error results clear trend to way they achieve maximum satisfaction to the patient. The important elements to consider when determining the accuracy of IL formula are small mean diffraction prediction error, smallest variance in that error, and highest percentage I within 0.5 diopter. Ideal formula would be the best combination of these formula. And the two benchmark study, the British National Health Services, that 55% of routine examination should give the 0.5 diopter result, and 85% should be within 1 diopter. And SCRA calculator gives the maximum satisfactory result. But among the SCRS calculator, the Barrett-2K method gives the most satisfactory results and basis high expectation. And the British National Health benchmark cataract surgery result. Ambari adjustment for the SRKT is fall short of this criteria. So our suggestion would be to utilize SRKT SARS average in combination with the individual Barrett-2K, OCT, and MASCAT to improve the desired outcome of cataract surgery in the post-cataract cases. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Agarwal, for your nice presentation. Yeah, of course, the sample size was a little small, so it's very difficult now to predict the reliability of the study. But
sir,
of course,
these are very few cases which come to our clinics, because the LASIK has come to in last 30 years, and these will turn into the cataract, and then this is so the sample size everywhere. The sample
small,
size
yes.
is not very small,
yes.
But even though there's trend says that if you use the Barrett-2K or the Barrett-2K no history, it gives maximum correction. Because I have used one Arambri correction for SRKT. Using the correction table, then I found that it has gone to the hyperopic correction. And after that, I have used this ASCRS calculator, and it also very good. But when we combine with the ASCRS calculator with the Barrett-2K, it gives very good and specific result and very close to 0.5
right.
to 1
yes.
diopter range. So it is more satisfactory to the patient, because this type of patient always needs. Always assumes that he or she will get very good results after the cataract surgery, because their habit is getting that after the LASIK.
Thank you very much. Is Dr. Sangeeta ready with her presentation? Dr. Sangeeta? Some technical. So then we will go ahead with the next presentation, that is, it's a keynote address. By Dr. Tejal SJ. Dr. Tejal? Not there. The next is the best free paper from Rajasthan Ophthalmology Society, and it is Dr. Amit Mohan who is going to present. Dr. Amit. Yeah. I will ask all the presenters to be prepared with their presentation, like preload the presentation.
Good afternoon, everyone. My topic is combined scleral fixated IUL and strabismus surgery. There is no financial interest. In clinical practice, it is not uncommon to find patients with both strabismus and aphakia. When treating such patients, the dilemma that clinician confronts is whether to manage strabismus and aphakia in two different surgical sessions or to combine the two operations into one. Simultaneous secondary IOL and strabismus surgery has received relatively little attention in previous literature. There is no literature available on combined scleral fixated IOL and strabismus surgery. Combining SFIOL lens procedure with strabismus corrections may reduce the number of surgical and anesthetic procedures, speed rehabilitations, and other financial benefit to the patient. Concern may arise regarding a potential increased risk of postoperative infection, anterior segment ischemia, postoperative ocular alignment, or excessive discomfort for the patients. Determining the ocular alignment in eyes with poor vision may be difficult. To address these issues, we herein present the retrospective result of 5 patients who underwent for these combined procedures. The records of 5 patients who underwent combined strabismus and SFIOL surgery were reviewed. All patients underwent comprehensive eye examination, including measurement of the angle of deviation. The measurement was performed by means of the alternate prism cover test after fitting appropriate contact lens in aphakic eye. Sensory evaluation could not be done in most of the patients because of obvious strabismus. Strabismus success was defined as a residual deviation of 10 prism diopter or less, and visual success was defined as a vision improvement more than 6/18. The operation performed were a standard strabismus procedure for the type and amount of deviation, followed by the appropriate procedure for SFIOL placements. Patients ranged from 13 years to 35 years with 3 males and 2 females. All patients had unilateral aphakia with no or inadequate capsular support. Preoperative visual acuity was less than 6/16 all 5 patients, but all of them had best corrected visual acuity is more than 6/18 with aphakic glasses. All cases were required aphakia following cataract surgery, out of which 4 were operated for traumatic cataract and 1 for dislocated lens. In total, 3 of strabismus surgery were performed for exotropia, 1 for esotropia, and 1 for combined vertical horizontal deviations. Strabismus success was achieved in 100% patient, and visual success was attained in all the eyes. There were no irreversible visually significant complication in any of the patients. This is the demographic data of my patients. This is the clinical characteristics of the 5 patients with combined SFIOL surgery, in which the age ranges from 13 years to 35 years, and postoperative visions were 6/6. When one patient is 6/6, and the minimum is 6/18 in one patient. And the fusion is attained in 3 patients, and 2 patients had separations. In the discussion, strabismus and is a common finding in unilateral aphakia with a reported frequency ranging from 27% to 100%. Various reports have suggested a difference in the frequency of development of strabismus depending on whether aphakia was treated with an IOL or contact lens. Esotropia was predominant in the first 2 years of life. At the end of the first decade of life, exotropia was up to 80%. A study done by the France et al. On 36 adult patients, out of which 69% of patients with acquired cataract or dislocated lenses presented with exotropia, and remaining 31% presented with esotropia. There's Malzman presented 10 cases of combined strabismus and IOL surgery with good results. There is also a report by Tico which shows there's no surgical anesthetic and postoperative complication other than unsatisfactory ocular alignment were limited to. In India, Guha et al. Evaluated the result of combined strabismus and cataract surgery in 50%, and motor alignment was achieved in 35.3%. and in group 1 and 75.8% in group 2. Considering all these facts, combined strabismus and SFIOL surgery outcomes were analyzed in our study in terms of visual improvement, ocular alignment, postoperative sensory status, and any unwanted complications. Results are rewarding with 100% improvement in vision, ocular alignment with attainment of fusion in 60% cases. There is no complication in any case. These 5 cases included 4 cases of previous ocular trauma resulting cataracts that had been removed. The patient could not wear contact lenses had developed and acquired exotropia over the years following the cataract surgery. One patient had juvenile esotropia with subluxated lens. In conclusion, simultaneous extraocular muscle and SFIOL surgery is safe and efficacious option for patients with strabismus and aphakia. The added advantage is avoidance of conjunctival scarring as in a staged surgery, because adequate conjunctival incision is necessary for both the procedure, and at the end of surgery, conjunctival closure should be meticulous. So combined surgery is beneficial in this situation to prevent complications associated with conjunctival adherence or improper closure. Further study is warranted to determine if this approach is comparably effective to consecutive lens and strabismus surgery. A standard strabismus surgical amount is recommended. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for the nice presentation. But you said your decision of doing together is based on your visual potential. The patient is going to get back how much of the visual potential. Do you assess them?
We decided on the after fitting contact lens whether we are able to, if the vision is more better than 6/18, and we are able to measure the deviations, then only we have decided for the for this combined surgery.
So what was your post-op, or within 10 degree you got it?
In all the five patients, the strabismus is less than 10 prism diopter post-operatively.
I think we believe the exotropia seems to be the position of rest. When there is a potential for vision is very poor, the eye moves to rest position. Even if we keep it with the correction, it will move on to the exotropia. And unless you explore the visual potential of the patient.
Okay, sir.
Mouse.
So,
thank you.
Okay, sir.
What was your follow-up time? How long you follow up these cases?
For 6 months.
6 months. After that, they lose follow-up.
Yes. We have not recorded after 6 months. The first we have done the strabismus surgery, then the SFIOL.
You were doing marking first
Yes, sir. With the scleral fixated IOL, we have sutured a scleral fixated IOL with fluorine angular suture, and we use the oral lenses.
Thank you, Amit. The next, Dr. Sangeeta is there. And I will ask Dr. Binesh Tyagi, the next presenter. Is he here? Yeah, you be prepare yourself on the next podium. Okay.
Good afternoon to one and all present here. Today I am presenting my paper on intraoperative floppy iris syndrome, a comparative study on use of intracameral adrenaline and low parameter phaco versus iris hook and Malleugin ring in patients undergoing cataract surgery. There is no financial disclosure. Now what is IFIS? Intraoperative floppy iris syndrome is characterized by three intraoperative features, which is flaccid iris stroma, a propensity for the floppy iris stroma to prolapse towards the phacoemulsification and sideport incisions, and progressive intraoperative pupil constriction despite standard preventive preoperative pharmacologic measures. The conventional methods of pupil stretching and partial thickness sphincterotomies worsens the situation of achieving mydriasis. Hence, in this study, we have attempted to determine whether epinephrine injected directly into the anterior chamber would be beneficial in these IFIS cases. The aims and objective of this study is to compare the safety and efficacy of intracameral adrenaline and low parameter phaco versus iris hook and Malleugin ring in intraoperative floppy iris syndrome patients undergoing cataract surgery, and to compare the final visual outcome in both the groups. It is a retrospective study, and cataract patients with a recorded IFIS of any severity occurring over this period identified and enrolled in a multivariate analysis. The study duration is 1 year, and it is a single surgeon setting. Group 1 consisted of IFIS patients with cataract removal using intracameral adrenaline combined with low parameter phacoemulsification, which included aspiration flow rate on the range of 15 to 20 cc per minute, VACOM up to 250 millimeter of mercury, and 60 to 70 centimeter of bottle height, and high viscosity OVDs like Viscote. In group 2, we put the IFIS patients with cataract removal using iris hooks and Malleugin rings. Now 80 patients were in group 1 and 43 patients were in group 2. The final visual outcome was determined and compared between the two groups based on best corrected visual acuity, posterior capsular rent incidence during surgery, and other complications like iris injury, bleeding, sphincter tear. Now here I presented three videos. In the first video we can see the use of intracameral adrenaline with low parameter of phaco. The parameters are already written in the right side. And then the phacoemulsification is carried out. In the second video, I've shown the insertion of Malleugin ring and then continuation of the phacoemulsification procedure. In the third video, I have seen the use of iris hook, four iris hook, and then continuation of the surgery. And after that, the PCIL is implanted in all the three cases. So in the first case, we have seen that the intraoperative pupil constriction is lesser with the use of intracameral adrenaline and low parameter of phaco. Now coming to results and observations of our study, IFIS was observed in 123 out of total 610 eyes, which is in a study duration of 1 year, which amounted to 2% of the total cataract patients. And the causes of IFACE was found to be maximum due to tamsulosin use, which is used for benign prostatic hyperplasia. And this is, again, the other causes were use of other benzodiazepine use, like psychiatric medications and other antihypertensive use, and some idiopathic causes. In our study, males were found to be more affected with IFACE than females. And the mean age of study, mean age duration was 70.5 years. Now this is a correlation of tamsulosin and IFACE in both the groups. And we have found that in both the groups, the tamsulosin use was the most common use, most common cause of IFACE. The mean preoperative pupil diameter was 5 millimeter in the study. However, the mean preoperative pupil diameter in group 1 was found to be 5.5 millimeter, and the mean preoperative pupil diameter in group 2 was 5 millimeter. Use of iris hook or Mallugan ring provided stable intraoperative pupil diameter, though there is a risk of iris trauma. Sphincter tears were found to be more common with the use of iris hooks. Mallugan device was faster and easier to insert, though there is risk of endothelial injury due to the girth, rigidity, and manipulation in anterior chamber. The PCR incidence was found to be more in group 2, that means with the use of iris hook and Mallugan ring. And other complications like iris trauma, bleeding, sphincter tear, iridocyclitis, and cystoid macular edema was also found to be more in the group 2 patients. So, coming to conclusion, the early diagnosis of IFACE reduces intraoperative complication rate and affect final visual outcome. And peroperative uses of intracameral adrenaline and low parameters was found to be safe and with good efficacy and cost effective for cataract removal in IFACE. Thank you.
That the adrenaline you get, how many minutes you have the effect when you inject it, how many times you inject before completing the case?
So before the completion of case, sir, after the wound construction, we put the intracameral adrenaline and then we proceed with the surgery. So the minimum duration of the surgery will be like 5 to 10 minutes, sir.
Usually the IFIS cases, the iris will be very unstable coming to the wound. And how does the adrenaline prevents that?
Sir, actually adrenaline with lidocaine combination
can dilate the pupil.
Sir, it can actually maintain the intraoperative pupil mydriasis, which is not possible with atropine or other pharmacologic measures, sir. And it has been studied with sugarcane solution also, sir. In sugarcane solution, we have used like BSS plus lidocaine and intracameral adrenaline. So here we have used just intracameral adrenaline, lidocaine, same BSS, not BSS plus.
There are two concerns in the IFACE one. One is pupil size and second is pupil iris prolapse. See, the pupil size you have taken care of with adrenaline, but once the pupil dilates, then chances of iris prolapse become more.
So for iris prolapse, sir, in IFACE cases, so we have to make a longer incision. So that will prevent the iris prolapse through the phacoemulsification and the side port wound. So that intraoperative measures will have to take, sir. Which is not included in this study, sir.
Longer incision will invite more iris.
Shorter incision will, sir, cause iris prolapse, sir, mainly.
I think you are telling just the other way. And have you tried doing a peripheral iridectomy to prevent iris prolapse?
No, sir. In this study,
any other, pupil dilating device other than Mallugan ring and iris
hook? No, sir. Only iris hook and Mallugan ring, sir.
There is have you tried phenylephrine injectable intracameral? Have you tried this?
No, sir, epinephrine, sir, in this case. Strength, sir, 1:4,000.
Not strength, but phenylephrine injectable.
No, sir, in this case we have not used, sir. Actually. In this study.
Thank you, Sangeeta. So now we move
thank
to
you.
The next presenter, Dr. Binesh Tyagi. Are you ready?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And I asked Dr. Narayan Bordoloi. Yeah, he's there. So please prepare yourself on the other podium, sir.
So good morning, everyone. Today my topic is comparison of Barrett's toric calculator with other toric calculators for IOL power calculation. Our one co-author, Dr. Sri Ganesh, is a consultant for Carl Zeiss Meditech and Johnson & Johnson. Other authors, including myself, have no financial disclosures here. So we all know that preoperative astigmatism is very common in cataract patients. 15 to 29% of cataract patients have astigmatism of more than 1.5 diopter. And also it is found that there is a difference between refractive and anterior corneal astigmatism in the human eye. Earlier the cause was not found, so initially they thought that it is posterior corneal role, but then it was dismissed because there was very minor difference between refractive indices of cornea and the aqueous. Then came the theory of retinal curvature, but it was also dismissed on the basis of retinoscopic studies. So interest came back to posterior corneal curvature. It was found that posterior cornea is steeper vertically and rather flatter horizontally, so it led to theory that whenever we are implanting a toric IOL, if we ignore the posterior corneal curvature, then there will be overcorrection in eyes having with the rule anterior corneal astigmatism and undercorrection in eyes having against the rule anterior corneal astigmatism. Also, it was noted that superior vertical thickness is more than inferior, so the posterior cornea produces asymmetric astigmatism and some higher order aberrations as well. So after that newer formulae, nomograms came, which incorporated the posterior corneal curvature. It started with Baylor nomogram, and they use a regression approach. Then newer formula like Barrett toric calculator has come, which is a theoretical formula. So here we are going to compare two calculators. One is Barrett, which do consider the posterior corneal curvature, and one is Checkney's toric calculator, which do not consider the posterior corneal curvature. So these are the online calculator, both are online calculator, and these are the links where we did all the calculations. So our study was a randomized prospective interventional study done for 1 year, total 50 patients, 50 eyes, so 25 eyes in each group. Now objective was to compare the residual astigmatism outcome difference with and without considering the posterior corneal curvature. The inclusion criteria minimum corneal astigmatism was 1 diopter as measured by the optical biometry. There should be adequate pupillary dilatation so that we can see the toric marker on the IOL, and at least one prominent episcleral vessel around the nimbus to work as a reference mark. Exclusion criteria was irregular corneal astigmatism, any form frustrate, keratoconus, abnormal topography, or if our optical biometry and our tomography, their axis is different by at least 10 degree. And then any other ocular history, trauma, any pathology, or like pterygium, they were ruled out. So all the axial length and keratometry was performed by IOL master, the optical biometry, and the power was entered on the online calculators. All patients underwent routine phacoemulsification surgery with foldable toric IOL. Technis toric lens was used for all the cases, and it was used with a Callisto system connected to microscope via forum viewer. Then follow-up was done on first day, 15 day, 3 months and 6 months. On all follow-up, subjective refraction was performed. Any rotation and alignment was checked using Zeldiver caliper of eye trace. And whenever we found that there was more than 5 degree of rotation, that is there a deviation from our intended axis, we excluded that patient from our study because we don't want any post-operative rotation bias in our study. Once we got all the data, all the relevant data was entered in online Bardell and Hardin astigmatic fixed calculator. It is a toric back calculator which gives the ideal axis for the present IOL. So ideal axis is that axis at which this present toric IOL will give minimum residual astigmatism. This data was analyzed. Age distribution, because it is a randomized study, so there was no difference, no significant difference in age. But coming to residual astigmatism, in Barrett, mean residual astigmatism was 0.44 diopter, while in Technis toric calculator, mean residual astigmatism was 0.68 diopter. P-value was 0.003, which is highly significant in favor of Barrett toric calculator. The mean difference between planned axis and ideal axis for the same IOL, in Barrett it was 5.68 degree mean, while in Technis toric it was 8.76 degree. Again, p-value is 0.009, which is significant, which says that in Barrett we have to rotate less to reach the ideal axis. So then on follow-up of 3 months and 6 months, there was actually no significant difference in these findings. So we come to the conclusion that IOL calculator, which consider the posterior corneal curvature, they give significantly lesser residual cylinder. And ideal axis in those tend to be closer to our planned or intended axis. Hence, the need for post-operative reorientation of IOL is significantly lesser. Our study helps to reiterate that posterior corneal curvature is a significant contributor to post-operative residual astigmatism. Hence, it needs to be addressed during surgical planning itself. As now, multiple formulae and nomogram are coming, which take into consideration the posterior curvature. Future prospective study comparing such calculator and nomogram are needed to further refine biometry. There are limitations to this thing. One is a university study limitation is there that sample size very small. Another limitation is not to our study actually, but we don't have any gold standard method which can accurately measure the posterior corneal curvature. So it is a bottleneck for the accurate biometry. As we come to any method where it will be individualized, their biometry will improve. As of now, Barrett or all calculator, they are based only on age-based normative data. Thank you, sir. These are my references. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, may I request now Dr. Narayan Bodoli to go ahead with the presentation. In the meantime, Dr. Deepak Megur, is he here? Yeah. You.
Good afternoon.
You're on the other podium, Dr. Deepak.
I'll be speaking on dropless cataract surgery. What is dropless cataract surgery? Is no eye drop during the post-operative period. How is done? We inject transannular injection of moxifloxacin and triamcinolone acetonide into the vitreous cavity. Why is necessary? Is the earliest rehabilitation one can assume, because putting eye drop is not a good thing always. It cuts costs. And most important, 50% of the cataract surgery patients, they have dry eye, and we can get rid of this accentuation of the dry eye by not putting any eye drop. So this is one small video where you can see that this patient is trying to put the eye drop into his eyes. His dexterity is very good, but at the last moment, he put the eye drop outside the eye over the lid. Look at the another patient. She is lying down nicely. Other person is putting eye drop. But look at the hygiene. No hygiene is taken care of. And at the end of putting the eye drop, this person wiped the eye with a dirty cloth. So these all things can be avoided by this new technique where you don't have to put any eye drop after the surgery. So this is the method after IOL insertion into the bag. The AC is filled with cohesive OBD, a mixture of 0.1 ml of each of triamcinolone acetate and moxifloxacin is injected into the anterior vitreous transannularly with a 27 gauge band cannula. Bimanual irrigation and aspiration is done to remove the OBD and to form the AC. So here is a series of cases. First, I am putting the IOL into the bag, normal procedure. Then I am putting OVD to create a space between the anterior lens capsule and the iris. Now I'm going in with the 27 gauge band cannula. And as soon as I reach the zonules, I inject the requisite amount of triamcinolone acetonide and the moxifloxacin. After that, I do some sort of irrigation because intraocular pressure rises and come. Here comes the second case, similar. I have introduced the lens, then again finding the space, creating the space, and again going in with the this triamcinolone acetonide injection and moxifloxacin, giving it. As you can see that there is rise of pressure, we go ahead with it. Then here is another thing similar. We are injecting and also putting transannular injection of things. So this is the technique we do. The aim of the study to evaluate the clinical outcome following intraoperative transannular intravitreal injection of triamcinolone in patient undergoing FACO with IOL implantation. This is a prospective, non-randomized, non-comparative clinical interventional study. Study period is from February 27 to July 17. Setting is at Jorhat. Inclusion criteria: patients who come for cataract surgery were informed about the dropless cataract surgery along with its pros and cons. Those who voluntarily give consent for the procedure were included in this study, excluded cases who have glaucoma or who have history of steroid responders. So these are the 60 cases. These are the male and female. Mean age is 61 years. And cataract density was mostly there, 4 and 4 plus, that is 22 cases. Preoperative vision was this amount. And these are the results. Postoperative vision, the 66%, 71% patients have 6-9 vision on day one, and ultimately all have good vision. We followed the cases up to 90 days. Then sales were extremely rare because we have already given triamcinolone. So sales were either occasional or nil. Floaters is one concern because we inject it, and definitely there will be sport floaters. So there were floaters in few cases. And the most beautiful thing was the post-operative results. The post-operative results were very good. And there were some intraoperative complications, like some intraoperative complication in the form of sometimes there is leakage of the things. Then sometimes there is bleeding that came in only one case bleeding that was easily controlled. And sometimes there is, to conclude, this procedure could be a boon to the working rural population of India, whom putting eye drop during working hours is not only difficult but unsafe as well. This can take phacoemulsification surgery to the next level, to the earliest and fastest rehabilitation any surgery can offer. Further extension of this study will probably answer the question whether post-op antibiotic is needed. Thank you.
The present our understanding is that after cataract surgery, the inflammation and cells are going on at least for 4 to 5 weeks. And do you have your triamcinolone effect lost for that 5 weeks?
For the?
Your steroid you are injecting.
Yeah.
Will that last for 5 weeks?
No. It will be there for maybe 2 months. Effect of triamcinolone will be there. Okay. But what I show is there, what I normally found cells and flare in normal situation, it is far less when I put the triamcinolone steroid, because it's a strong steroid.
And another understanding is that triamcinolone, irrespective of the steroid responder, it produces the increased intraocular pressure.
Yeah, that is true. In least 60 cases, we have not encountered any intraoperative, any postoperative IOP. We have followed it up to 90 days. And as I said, this is an ongoing studies. The number have increased now to 240. But fortunately, believe me, there is no case of postoperative rise of IOP. There is not a single case.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
I think I agree with doctor, that there is a chance of the increased IOP, even though you have excluded the group who has a steroid responder. And second thing, any of your patient has complained about the foreign body sensation, foreign body or a floater, something like a floater in the vitreous, because they complained repeatedly. It takes a long time to get absorbed.
Yeah.
So floaters is a very constant complaint in this thing.
Yeah,
any
floaters,
of your patients has complained like this?
Floaters is an issue, but before we take the consent, we explain to the patient that this will be a thing you may expect. And on the OT table itself, when I inject, I keep telling the patient that we have put the medicines into your eyes. They will keep coming to you in front of your eyes for a few days. Please don't worry. So because of this, maybe counseling, people didn't complain of floaters.
Narayan, a surgeon of your caliber may inject it very easily. But do you think, because there are 3-4 concerns for us. One, the injecting intraoperatively. Second, the bleeding part. And third, as our chairperson has told, the increase in intraocular pressure. So we have to judge it on the merits and demerits of in both the cases.
Yeah, so I admit that this is a blind procedure because you cannot see the zonules. You enter into that area, then you assume that these are the zonules, so you inject. So there is a blind procedure, number one. Number two, this takes a learning curve. So that bleeding case, that occurred only once during my early period. Probably I hit the ciliary body. And after that, there was no bleeding. So it takes little time, but as things goes by right now, it looks very promising to me.
Yeah, please.
To work from next day. Only my concern is, it could be a theoretical concern, but as we all know, there may be some contamination in the eye during surgery. That's the reason many of us use moxifloxacin as a routine. Now, we are assuming that that contamination, that bacteria is sensitive to the moxifloxacin, but It is maybe a theoretical possibility, it may not be so. So in that case, what we are doing, we are suppressing the body's response to the bacteria with the steroid. At the same time, we are not protecting that person with the appropriate antibiotic. It may be a theoretical concern, but it's a concern. Another thing, is it possible that we can inject this thing after a week? The same thing is very good, as because a lot of patients, they complain bitterly about foreign body sensation, and a lot of people, they have to at least stay off work for 7 days. So, by one week, we'll know whether the patient has got any serious contamination with bacteria. We'll know if we inject that, then my theoretical concern will be addressed.
Thank you, sir. We got the point. Yes, Dr. Narayan, please.
I'll answer.
Please.
First is moxifloxacin injection will increase the contamination. Now it has become a rule because Arvind has published a big paper on it, the efficacy of moxifloxacin, that is intracameral, and that has reduced rate of endophthalmitis. So that is proven. And number two, as you suggested, can we do it after a week? I think this is not possible because you will have to take the patient again to the OT, do the whole procedure.
The whole procedure has to be repeated.
You have to open the eye
again.
Exactly. So I think practically it is not possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Narayan. So the next paper is by Dr. Deepak Meghul. Are you ready, Deepak? And now I request Dr. Anita Ambasta. She's there? Yeah. So you be prepared on the next year. We are running short of time, because it was supposed to be till 1:25.
Okay. Please, respected chairperson, I'll be presenting my paper on multi-piece IOL, placement of multi-piece IOL in sulcus and CTR insertion in the back for eyes with weak zonules. Can I have my slide running, please? Play button. Okay, so I don't have any financial interest. Traditionally, the technique has been for localized eyes with localized zonular dehiscence. We put the CTR in the bag and also IOL in the bag. So this has been the technique which I have been following for years now. There's not been a big issue, but very rarely we still see that there has been concern over the long-term stability, especially eyes with pseudo exfoliation. We see there's a late onset dislocation. So I'm presenting a new technique called as the IOL trap technique, wherein the CTR is there in the bag, which provides the equatorial expansion and 360° support to the bag, plus an hydrophobic multi-piece IOL in the sulcus with optic capture in the rexus margin. The aim was to analyze the outcomes of placing a multi-piece hydrophobic lens in sulcus with optic capture in CCC along with the CTR in the bag in eyes which had weak zonules. Trauma and pseudo-exfoliation formed the major compartment of these 28 eyes. The important inclusion criteria here was the zonular dehiscence has to be localized. It is not more than 3 clock hours and mild to moderate generalized zonular weakness which we see in pseudo-exfoliation. So these are the two important inclusion criteria which we had. The procedure was using phacoemulsification to remove the cataract, CTR was placed in the bag, and a hydrophobic multi-piece IOL was placed in the sulcus with optic capture. The outcome measures which we studied was IOL centration and bag stability over a period of time. We took serial slit lamp photographs, both retroillumination and diffuse illumination, to document the change which happened over a period of time. Now, coming to the technique, this is one such case where a 70-year-old man with blunt trauma having 3 clock hours of zonular dehiscence. The most important criteria would always be to get the rexus right with adequate centration, and I am using a CTR. The timing can be different in individualized based on surgeon preference and all. I prefer to use it a little bit earlier. The cataract is removed, the hydrophobic lens is placed in the sulcus, and we remove the OVD first, both in front and behind the lens meticulously. Once it is done, I gently tap the intraocular lens back into the bag. The ovalization of the rexus is indicative of the optic capture which you have achieved. So this is how the post-op appearance would be. The rexus would appear something oval like this. This is the lens is trapped behind the rexus margin. This is the same eye 20 months post-op, appears to be well-centered and stable. This is another such case where the insertion of CTR has been deferred and is then being done after the cataract is placed here. And again, once the OVD is removed, the optic of this hydrophobic multi-piece lens is gently maneuvered into the bag with the haptics being in the sulcus. Again, the ovalization of the rexus is a clear-cut indicator that we have achieved a perfect optic capture inside the rexus margin. Moving on to this case, again a case which localized the 3 clock hours zonular. The getting the CCC centering and sizing right is probably the most important step because it will be slightly decentered. We have to accommodate the rexus also like that, so they're slightly decentered, keeping in mind about this thing. In few cases, we may have a rexus which is slightly larger and slightly eccentric. In this situation, ensuring that we need to get some amount of optic capture like this and some amount of overlap of the rexus is critical. So this is, you have to maneuver the lens where you have the access of the overlapping of the CCC. Among the 28 eyes, blunt trauma accounted for 20 eyes which had localized zonular dehiscence, and pseudo-exfoliation accounted for 8 eyes with generalized mild localized weaknesses. These are demographic data. The minimum follow-up period was 18 months and the average follow-up period was 24 months in our series of patients. It's still ongoing. The results were in 26 eyes, we had got excellent centration over a period of the follow-up which we had. 2 eyes were mild decentration but did not have any effect on the visual outcome. This is the photographs of some of the patients here. The limitation of this study was no control. Obviously, it cannot be possible because they're all trauma cases. We can't have bilateral similar cases. To conclude, multi-piece hydrophobic lens in sulcus with optic capture with CTR in the bag is a good option in select group of patients. The primary benefit is centration. The secondary benefit which I have noticed is the amount of pseudo-vacunodosis which we see is significantly lesser. Although it is there, it is much less than what we have in everything in the bag, where everything will be moving. Coming to the philosophy of how it is going to work is, you know, we are keeping the equatorial stretch and expansion is maintained by the CTR. And the optic capture which is achieved by the hydrophobic lens. The haptic is much more anterior than the sulcus. The haptic is in the sulcus and the optic is pushed back behind the CCC. The redistribution of the weight around the capsular bag is what is critical for us. This is reduces the weight of the bag, and that is how we are hoping and that long-term decentration and dislocation is being prevented. The anterior pull by the haptics balances out the posterior force extended by the bag and the weak zonules. Once you obtain the optic capture, and we can see that there is an anterior pull of hoping that the anterior pull is working against to balance out the posterior pull exerted by the weak zonules and the bag over a period of time. There are 2 or 3 important critical factors for this technique to work. The first is centering and sizing of the rexus. This has to be very good to achieve this. And most important is the hydrophobic multi-piece lens. Because we are all aware that the rexus margin literally glues to the optics. This is a photograph showing the rexus margin to glue to the optics of this. And this gluing of this optic to the anterior capsular margin along with an anteriorly placed haptic is critical to counterbalance the posterior pull of the weak zonules, and that's how the philosophy of this technique is. Thank you so much for attention.
Thank you, sir. There is already existing study that when you put a optic capture in an unfoldable lens, you get ciliary body stimulation, you get constant uveitis. You must make sure that this particular lens is not irritating ciliary body when by optic capture, one. Next point I would like to mention is that the point of a weakness is the zonule. So you must make sure the zonule is well centered rather than the optic well centered. When the entire zonule moves, the back moves, so there is no point in trapping the optic of the eye well.
Answering the second point, sir, the CTR does a function of giving 360 degree support to the back. So you have a zonular weakness of 3 clock hours, but the CTR, which is placed inside, that is responsible for giving 360 degrees equatorial support to the back. The optic is just, optic is not going to support the back at all. Haptic is going to be there in the sulcus, optic is going to be inside the rexus margin. The support to the back is provided by the ring, sir. Coming to the first question that the uveitis being caused. These are all haptics of the multi-piece lenses. They don't cause any of the irritation of the uveal tissue or inducing any uveitis as such. The hydrophobic lens material can cause irritation of the ciliary body if it is kept in the sulcus. The optic part, which is made up of the hydrophobic, is always in the bag. It's in behind the rexus margin, and the haptics which are there in sulcus are not of hydrophobic material. They are made up of PMMA and proline, and they do not cause any irritation because this is a technique which you always follow whenever there is a PC tear. So we always use this multi-piece lens to capture.
Next study of your patient, sir. This is our information. We want to pass it on to you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'll be talking on safety and efficacy of fibrin glue versus sutures in sealing large incisions in manual small incision cataract surgery. To tackle this, the cataract surgical rate in India has to be 6,500 per million population by the year 2020. And the most common modality of doing cataract extraction is still going to be the manual SICS, many of which will be done by young surgeons, new surgeons who are not that proficient in making the scleral tunnel. These are certain scleral flap-related problems which can occur, a large incision size with extended scleral flap, again a large incision with a buttonhole, a thin flap, and a deep incision can lead to hyphema. Now, problems with these flaps is that it can lead to compromised scleral tunnels and loss of the self-sealing ability, which can lead to wound gape, wound leak, which in turn can lead to unpredictable astigmatism and endophthalmitis. Now, these are managed usually by putting sutures, but sutures we know are associated with giant papillary conjunctivitis and foreign body sensation. Now, these are some pictures of suture-related problems. We can see exposed suture not there, suture infection leading to endophthalmitis, a wound gape, this probably required 2 infinity sutures, and a cut through because there was a thin scleral flap. Now, so to obviate these problems, we decided to use biologic fibrin glue and to compare it with infinity sutures. Aim of the study was to compare safety and efficacy of fibrin glue versus horizontal sutures to seal large scleral incisions and compromised scleral flaps in manual small incision cataract surgery. This was a retrospective study done over a 2-year period. The patients were 19 in number, divided into 2 groups. Group A, where small incision cataract surgery with infinity suture was done. Group B, where SICS with biologic fibrin sealant was used. Inclusion criteria was patients with large incisions and compromised scleral flap in SICS. Follow-up was done on post-op day 1 at the end of 1, 4, 6 weeks, and 6 months, respectively. As to the surgical method, this is intraoperative picture where there was a torn extended flap in a patient with SICS. The AC is not getting formed. We can see that the side port has been hydrated, and yet we see presence of DM folds. So the AC is formed with the help of air bubble, and this will also prevent the fibrin from trickling inside, as we thought. And then a thin layer, the wound area, that is the scleral incision site, is dried meticulously with the help of a meroseal sponge because fibrin works best in a dry field. And then a thin film of glue is applied along the whole length. We wait for a minute for the glue to act, and then the conjunctiva is brought forward similarly and sealed. This is another case where extended scleral flap was there in a case of SICS, and after the injection of air, a double applicator was used to put the fibrin glue along the scleral flap and seal it. This is anterosegment OCT showing that at the after 4 weeks, the incision site has healed and the glue is no longer seen. The primary outcome measures was post-operative AC depth and inflammation, and the secondary outcome measure was intraocular pressure and surgically induced astigmatism. This is the mean age and the mean size of the incision was comparable in both the groups, and the mean size of the incision was more than 7 mm in both the groups. These are the results of group A where we had used sutures. The wound was well opposed on all follow-up days except on day one in one case where there was a wound gap which was small but it healed at the end of 4 weeks. Due to conjunctival recession, at the end of 1 week, we had exposed knots in 5 cases. These knots were removed after healing had taken place on 4 weeks. Inflammation was considered to be normal if it was 2+ in the first week and 1+ later on. AC death was seen clinically and it was seen to be formed on all days, and ROP was within normal limits on all follow-up visits. These are some post-op pictures of the suture group. These are results of the group B where glue had been used. There was no wound gape on any follow-up visit, except in one case at the end of 1 week where we saw presence of a subconjunctival bleb. However, the IOP was normal, the AC was formed, yet we did a wound revision and put an infinity suture there. Amount of inflammation was within normal limits on all follow-up visit. Anterior chamber was formed on all days, and IOP was also within normal limits on all days. This is the subconjunctival bleb which we saw in the glue group at the end of 1 week. On comparing the mean SI between both the groups, both the results were comparable on all follow-up days, except at the end of 1 week, where we found more than expected mean SIA in group B, which could be due to the presence of the case with subconjunctival bleb, or there might have been some degree of wound slide, because the fibrin clot takes around 2 weeks to consolidate. We can see the spike here at the end of 1 week in the bar chart. Fibrin glue acts by promoting collagen formation and cross-linking, and thus promotes natural wound healing. And a two-step vapor heating process ensures viral safety. Discussion: none of the patients in a glue group had any complaints of discomfort. This is because the glue forms a smooth seal across the whole wound edge. However, sutures had to be removed in 5 patients. And according to one study, this 10-0 monofilament disintegrates after 3 months, which could lead to loosening of the knots and foreign body sensation. Inflammation was within normal limits in both the groups. According to one study, fibrin glue has been used to close traumatic defects of the lens capsule without reporting any side effects. Well-formed AC was found in all cases. In one case in one group, we had presence of a subconjunctival bleb. This patient had history of premature wound entry, and it could be that because of the aqueous leak, the fibrin had got diluted, leading to suboptimal action, or that the fibrin had not been prepared properly, leading to suboptimal action of the fibrin. At the end of 6 months, difference in mean SI between both the groups was not significant. We observed higher mean SI in both the groups as compared to other studies, which could be because our incision size was more and our incisions were button-holed or torn in many cases. Fibrin sealant thus in SI cases remains a useful hemostat sealant and adhesive. Cost of fibrin glue is definitely a limiting factor, and probably we need more number of patients and a prospective study. To conclude, fibrin glue is safe and effective in sealing large scleral incisions in manual SI cases and can be used as an alternative to sutures without having suture-related complications. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Anita. Any questions from
you? Prepare the fresh glue every time, and it lasts for how many hours?
4 hours, sir.
4 hours.
Yes, sir.
So you can use till 4 hours.
We use it if it prepares. We use it in one OT.
OT, you have to finish that.
Yes, we finish it all.
Okay.
Thank you. It's a good alternative. Definitely, we do agree. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Anita. So with this, we come to the end of this session. And now I thank all the presenters for their excellent presentation and all the chairpersons. And I hand over the hall for the next session.